Today, as we kick off the summer season, I want to begin a new series of sermons entitled Living the Christian Life Day by Day. In almost two decades of serving churches, I've witnessed one consistent reality among believers. There are a lot of different ideas surrounding what the Christian life should be. For some, the Christian life is a list of rules that should be followed in order to earn God's favor. For others, the Christian life is a set of ideas that should be accepted without any effect upon our daily living. For others still, the Christian life is a mystical reality that can only truly be experienced by the super Christians. But as we look at the scriptures, the Christian life is not this deeply hidden secret, nor is it simply a set of rules or ideas. Rather, the Christian life is practical instruction that forms the basis for every point of daily life. This week, as we begin looking at Paul's letter to the Colossians, I want to lay a foundation for living the Christian life day by day. We're not actually going to deal with the nuts and bolts. We'll start that next week. This week, we just want to lay some foundational realizations down to help us effectively live the Christian life as we put the nuts and bolts into place. One thing I've discovered is that a poor foundation will result in problems with every bit of construction that is placed upon it. How have I done such things? Because we've been remodeling this week. And you will be amazed at what you find under your floor when you pull the carpet. And in the midst of some of those things, I discovered that you have to lay the foundation right, or nothing else is going to be right. You can do everything regarding the nuts and bolts, and if we miss the foundational elements, you will miss living the Christian life day by day. So I invite you to look with me in Colossians chapter 2. We're going to be reading verses 4 through 7 this morning. And as we look at these verses, I want us to walk away from today with a new resolve to know the Lord Jesus Christ personally and intimately, and with a new commitment to live the Christian life day by day because of who the Lord Jesus is and what He has done. And so at this time, I invite you to stand as we honor God's presence upon His Word. And we read Colossians chapter 2, verses 4 through 7 together this morning. And the Word of the Lord says this: I am saying this so that no one will deceive you with persuasive arguments. For I may be absent in body, but I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see how well ordered you are in the strength of your faith in Christ. Therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, overflowing with gratitude. Let's pray. Our Father, as we come to you at this time, we pray that you would empower us to preach. For it is through the foolishness of preaching that your wisdom is revealed. And so I pray, Lord, that as we look at your word, and as the truth of your word is proclaimed, that hearts and lives would be gripped by the power of your Holy Spirit. And that, Lord, you would move as only you can in lives that need what only you can bring to produce the fruit that only you can produce. And it's in your precious and holy name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. The letter to the Colossians, which remains my all-time favorite epistle in all of the Bible, was written to a church that was doing a lot of great things. As Paul was in prison, a fellow worker in ministry had come and reported to him about what was going on in the church at Colossae. And they were telling him about the great things that were happening and how God was moving and how lives were being changed and they were being touched. And in the midst of that, this report that caused him great concern. For while they were doing many great things, a false teaching around who Jesus is and what Jesus has done began to move into the church. A false idea began to take root. And Paul understood that if this was not properly dealt with, swiftly and surely, no less than the health and well-being of the church was at stake. And so Paul sat down in his prison cell and he quickly wrote this letter with this overarching theme: the Christ of the church. And I always share that theme, but there is a second part to that theme. It is the Christ of the church and what difference he makes. And so it is against that backdrop that Paul shares these verses. Paul has spent time laying the foundation of who Jesus is. And let me tell you, Jesus is something else. If you want to really get a grasp of who Jesus is, take a look back in Colossians chapter 1 and start in verse 15. And I'm going to just quickly read this. We're not going to spend a whole lot of time here. But I want you to get a big picture idea of who Jesus is. Paul writes that he is the image of the invisible God. Think about that. In Christ we see the unseeable. He's the firstborn over all creation. He takes the seat of primacy. There is nothing that carries more weight, nothing that holds a place of more prominence, nothing that is more important, nothing of greater value than the Lord Jesus. For everything was created by Him in heaven and on earth, the visible and the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through Him, and all things have been created for Him. Our dear brother shared a little bit ago that every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Everything is created for Him. You, your stuff, your thoughts, your goals, your dreams, the totality of all that you are, the totality of all that you will ever be, was created by Him for Him. He is before all things, and by Him all things hold together. Think about that. You would not be sitting here if Christ was not holding you together. You would literally fly apart. The very laws of nature that govern the totality of who we are held in place by the Lord Jesus Christ. That there is not one thing that holds together that He is not the force holding it in place. He is also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that He might come to have first place in everything. For God was pleased to have all of His fullness dwell in Him. All the God that has ever been God dwelt physically and bodily in the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that. The God that spoke and created everything, the fullness of God, dwelling in the Lord Jesus. And through Him to reconcile everything to Himself, making peace through the blood of His cross, whether things on earth or things in heaven, that through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, all things will be brought into proper reconciliation with Him, either through submission and repentance of our lives, or through judgment and absolute destruction through His work. But all things will be reconciled to God through the Lord Jesus. That's who we're dealing with here. That's who Jesus is. And it is the foundation upon which Paul's instruction for living the Christian life is based. And so we move on to chapter 2, verse 4. And Paul offers us three realizations we have to grasp if we're really going to live the Christian life every day. So we look at these verses, the first realization we must face is the destructive reality of false teaching. Paul states that he's writing to the church so that they are not deceived with persuasive arguments. Over the centuries, many have come with persuasive arguments in an effort to lead the church away from the biblical, historical Jesus, what he has done, and what he continues to do. Many have done so with malice and deceit in their heart, but many have done so with love and sincerity and a genuine desire to see things be better and be different. But here's the deal. The motive in this case does not matter. Whether false teaching is rooted in malice and evil and wickedness, or it's rooted in love and compassion and sincerity, false teaching is a destructive creature that will ruin your life and your family and your church. False teaching kills you. The hope and only hope we have for salvation and power to live the Christian life is through orthodoxy around who Jesus is. We must right think about the Christ, and false teaching damages that. Oh, I know, we would never openly accept false teaching. I don't think the Colossians would have either. But it can be so simple. Sometimes it slips in by something as simple as, you know, I was praying the other night and I felt the Lord tell me we need to do fill in the blank. We say, well, you know, that can happen. Yes, it can. But I'll tell you, a few years ago, there was a very popular Christian artist that had an affair. And once the affair became public, this person came forth and said, well, as I was praying and really seeking the Lord, I felt that what I need to do is divorce my spouse. Because that's what the Lord's told me to do. Now, I can assure you that what did not happen was God tell that person to divorce their spouse. I can say that absolutely. How can you say that? Because Jesus is abundantly clear about the issue of divorce in Matthew 19. And the offending party in an affair isn't the one that has the right to walk away. That's not what Jesus says explicitly. I can make that up, but I can read between the lines. I don't have to. That's not it. God did not tell that person that. But that's what they said. That the Lord told them to do that. They got some special revelation that contradicts the Bible. No. You may be sitting there thinking, well, I would never do that. No, but I'm sure we've all, that his thought has at least crossed my mind. Well, God wants me to be happy. The Bible doesn't say that. But we sure like to think it, don't we? God wants me to be happy. Sometimes we say it this way. Well, I feel it in my heart that I know this is right. I feel it in my heart I know this is right. Guys, that could be pizza that you had last night. I'm just saying. That's heresy. Sometimes we like to whitewash the parts we don't like about what Scripture tells us. Jesus told us something. We don't really feel comfortable with that, so we go, well, I just don't know that we need to focus so much on fill in the blank. Hell, holiness, righteousness, submission, lordship. You know, anything that kind of infringes on what we want to do, sometimes we like to whitewash that a little bit. Sometimes when we're confronted with the reality of our sin, we say extra biblical things like, well, I'm only human. Nowhere is that an excuse in the Bible. That's not there. I don't ever see Peter when Jesus looks at him and says, get behind me, Satan. Peter looks at him and says, well, you know, Lord, I'm only human. No. reality of things doesn't mean that's the prescription of how we ought to live. Just because everyone sins doesn't mean you need to be practicing to get better at it. That's not what we're called to. That's not the life we're invited to live. But so often we will allow false teaching to start to color our thinking. I've shared it numerous times, my favorite southern expression among church people. Well, God knows my heart. My favorite response to that is, and that should terrify you. God knows your heart. All of the deceitful wickedness that lives within it. All of the vile, disgusting things that operate within you. God knows every bit of it. And that should terrify you. That's not an excuse for why you live like the devil. That's a terrifying reality that we will all face one day. Because the deepest secrets of our heart will be fully exposed. You know who really doesn't know your heart? You. That's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says your heart is deceitfully wicked above all else. That it is irreparable. That no one can really know just how vile and deceitful your heart is. You want to follow that? God told you to trust your heart? No! You want to let that determine your happiness and your righteousness? No! False teaching will kill you. It will kill your home. It will kill your family. It will kill your relationships. It will kill your walk with God. It will kill you. So we must guard against false teaching. How do we do that? Here's a novel thought. We know the Bible. If you want to know about God, what God has done, what God is like, who God is, how God has accomplished, if you want to know truth without any mixture of error, it is the Bible. It is the source and the hope that we have of God's revelation to His creation. The way we combat false teaching is we know truth. Because discernment is not necessary to recognize the lie. I look outside and I tell you it's dark. You don't need deep discernment to realize I'm lying to you. Discernment is being able to identify the 90% truth. That thing that sounds right but doesn't quite line up the way it might need to. And only as we know the Scripture can we truly inoculate ourselves to false doctrine and false teachings that infiltrate our lives and our church. We must guard against falsehood. But the second realization we must face within this passage is the essential need to have received Jesus. Notice this, we have to know the truth about Jesus before we can actually receive Jesus. There are many wonderful people who have been in church their whole lives who have never received the biblical Jesus because the Jesus they got was an idol of their own making. He was a Jesus that was going to be their best friend, or a Jesus that was going to meet all their needs, or a Jesus that was going to get them out of their trouble. And they never came face to face with the objective realities of who they were really dealing with, and they never truly submitted and surrendered to the Savior and Lord that is the biblical Jesus. But you cannot live the Christian life apart from the Christ. And so we must receive Jesus. Guys, this is not simply a moment where you prayed a prayer, or when someone took you down to the creek and put you under the water. Rather, it is a moment where you submitted your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, turned from your sin, and trusted that what He has done was more than enough to deal with your sin problem. And anything less than that is less than receiving Jesus. Anything less than a moment when you were given eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord was less than receiving Jesus. In every person who is going to live the Christian life, there has to be a point where they have come face to face with the reality of their sinfulness, where they have come face to face with the reality of their hopeless state in the face of that sinfulness, where they have believed that what the Lord Jesus Christ has done through His sinless life, sacrificial death, and glorious resurrection was enough to satisfy God's justice and provide a means for the forgiveness of sins and an empowerment for a new life through what He's done in submission to Jesus as our Lord. If those objective realities have not been obtained, you are not saved. Let me say that very clearly. If you've never turned from your sin, trusted in the person and work of the Lord Jesus, and are living in submission through the power He put in your life when He changed you. The key part there is He changed you. You're lost. You have not received Jesus. And you cannot live the Christian life apart from receiving Jesus. It is the foundation upon which the Christian life is built. But my hope is that today, if you find yourself in that place, you do not leave here still a citizen of the dominion of darkness, but rather that you will experience Christ and receive Him today and be transferred out of that dominion into the kingdom of the Son God loves. And that you would receive Christ today. Because to live the Christian life, you must have received Jesus. And then the third and final realization we have to face today is that there is a continuous charge to live the Christian life. Paul calls for the Colossians to walk in the Lord Jesus. Now we also were heirs of that charge. This isn't the only place Paul tells us this. It's a common theme. Walk is Paul's favorite term to describe our lifestyle. The way we live every day, day in, day out, is our walk. But Paul says, for your day-to-day living, that day-to-day how you live, breathe, talk, do, all of that is to be done in Him. That the practical aspects of daily life will be rooted and built up in the Lord Jesus. Guys, the Christian life isn't supposed to be our Sunday self. It's supposed to be our Monday self at work and our Tuesday night down at the Little League field self and our Saturday morning hanging around the house self. The Christian life is supposed to flow out of us and overflow out of us in every relationship, situation, circumstance, and event that takes place in our life. It should be embodied in everything we say, everything we do should reflect the change Christ has brought within us and the life we live. There are no days off. You know, I think sometimes we kind of try to live 4 or 5 good days in a row and then we think we get a day off from living like a Christian. We get a day off from living the Christian life. Get a day off from following Jesus. I'm just going to do what I want to do today. There are no days off. Guess what? There are no moments off. There are no moments within the days where it is appropriate to live in any way that is sub-Christian. There are no seconds off. There are no seconds within the moments where it is acceptable to live in anything less than absolute submission to the Lordship of your Savior. The Christian life of our lives. That is the charge we have been given. And thank God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, it's what you've been empowered to do. Here's the thing, guys. Ought equals can. If the Bible tells us to do it, the Holy Spirit empowers and enables you to do it. It's not a lack of power. It's not a lack of resources that keeps us from living the Christian life every day. But it can be a lack of commitment. It can be a lack of submission within our own lives that keep us from living as we ought to live. But here's the good news. You can commit anytime and plug into what God has provided for you to do it. Isn't that great news? It's not a one shot. If you miss it, it's over. It's not a situation where, you know, you got to jump through a whole bunch of hurdles and hoops to get there. God wants you to be there. And He has provided everything you need to be there. Today, I am imploring you to live out your calling and walk in the Lord Jesus. These three realizations must take root if we are to truly live out the Christian life. We must realize that false teaching will destroy your daily walk with the Lord Jesus. It can short-circuit any chance you have of living out the Christian life. Secondly, we must realize that there is a point where we had to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. If you have not done that, that is the step you need to take today. To trust in Him as Savior and Lord and be changed by Him. And finally, we must recognize that it is a constant charge for us to live out the Christian life in the Lord Jesus. As these realizations settle upon us, they should move us to know Christ more personally and more intimately. And they should move us to greater resolve to live the life Christ has enabled and empowered us to live more faithfully. I know this comes as a shock to some of you, but you have not arrived. You can do better. I can do better. We can do better. Those areas that remain unconquered within our lives, they can be submitted to the power of the Holy Spirit. They can be molded and shaped and changed as God has called us as we live daily. For those of you that have known Christ 20 years, great news, the easy stuff should be conquered. But now it moves to the harder things, those things we haven't been willing to give up for 20 years. And those things can be conquered too. For the one who gets saved today, you can experience a change of life and a new power through the Lord Jesus Christ that enables you to begin walking with Him, living a new life through Him. But it won't be easy. And it'll never be done until we enter into eternity with Him. But today, you can know Jesus. You can receive, you can walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him, overflowing about Him, celebrating what He's done, and you can be changed. In just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. In just a moment, I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer, and during that time, I'm going to make my way to the floor. Wayne's going to come back to the platform to lead us in our invitation hymn. And as I close that prayer and Wayne invites you to stand, that is your opportunity to respond this morning. Maybe you're here and you've never received Jesus and you know that today is the day, that now is the time. And this morning Christ is calling to you. As we begin to sing that invitation hymn, my charge to you is to step into any one of these aisles and meet me right down front here as you respond to Christ's call upon your life. And as you respond, I'll pray with you here. And as we close this service, I'll take time. We'll go back to the office. We'll thoroughly discuss what it truly means to receive Jesus. And we will leave here today with you submitted to your Savior. And maybe you're here and you know that Christ is calling you to renew your commitment to walk with Him. And this morning you know that you need to come and you need to repent, you need to pray, you need to seek Him. If Christ is calling you, then my invitation to you is for you to come and to pray at this altar. You're welcome to pray with me. You're welcome to bring somebody to pray with you. But this morning, if Christ is calling you, and you know that He's calling you to renew your commitment to Him, to walk with Him daily, then I invite you to respond this morning as well as you rededicate and recommit yourself to your Savior today. This is the time. This is the opportunity God has afforded you to respond to His call. This is your opportunity to respond to His invitation. If you will, I invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes. As we go to the Lord in prayer, allow Him to search your heart and allow Him to speak to you as we enter this time together.